Look, it's really a fantastic privilege to be introducing Director Park Chan-wook this morning, who has come to us from Korea. Obviously, you'll be familiar with his work. That's why you're here. But I thought it would just be worth recapping on a few of his many achievements. It was while studying as a student of philosophy at University in Seoul that Park saw Vertigo, decided to become a filmmaker. He made two feature films, which were not successful. It's okay to say that because he told me that. Following which, he made his living as a film critic, which he assures me is just as difficult in Korea as it is in New Zealand. Things changed in 2000 when he made Joint Security Area, which was the most viewed film at that time in Korean history. And on the basis of that, he went on to make his Vengeance trilogy, Sympathy for Mr. Vengeance, Old Boy, and then Sympathy for Lady Vengeance. Old Boy is, of course, the film that really broke wide open on the world stage. It won the Grand Prix at Cannes, and as a result of that film, director Park counts amongst his many fans Quentin Tarantino. Following that, he made Thirst in 2009, which won the Jury Prize at Cannes. And just to put director Park's career in perspective, he's the kind of guy that gets offered Evil Dead to direct and he turns that down. And he gets offered Tinker Tailor Soldier Spy and he turns that down. He chooses instead to direct a film on his iPhone, which gets selected for Berlin. He then makes his first English language film, Stoker, which a number of us were lucky enough to see the other night, starring Mia Wasikowska and Nicole Kidman. And he is obviously here with us today. And I think that to put his work in context, one way of describing it is to say that there's filmmakers that we admire and there's films that we really look forward to seeing to. And then there are some people who make films that actually redefine what you thought a film could be. They create the images and the stories and the characters that are with you from the day you first saw that movie for the rest of your life. There's only very, very few filmmakers on the planet at any one time who are doing that, and director Park is one of them. We're going to throw to a trailer very shortly for Stoker, just for those of us who didn't see it the other night. But I also wanted to make a very special thanks to director Park's translator here, who Mr. Wong Jo-jeong. Obviously from Korea, born and raised in Korea until the age of 12 years old when his family moved to Wellington. Studied at Victoria University, and that explains the impeccable Kiwi accent that he has. I was informed by Director Park that actually Wong Jo had a pretty pivotal role in the fact that he's here, given that the invitation from Script to Screen to come to the Big Screen Symposium had not only arrived in Seoul, but had been accepted on Director Park's behalf before he had actually seen it. So I'd like to give a special hand to Wong Jo for that. Thank you very much. And without further ado, I'm going to throw to Rob Sarkis, who's going to conduct the session. But before that, we're just going to watch the trailer for Stoker. Cheers.
Well, welcome. we'll get straight into it, and what I hope will be as relaxed a conversation as we can via Wong Jo, with some time for some questions from the audience at the end of the session. We'll make sure we leave 10 minutes at least for that. So you started as a philosophy student, and then one day saw a very famous film from Alfred Hitchcock. Can you tell me about the moment when you decided you wanted to be a filmmaker?
Yeah, 사실 철학 전공이라고는 하지만 제가 듣기를 원했던 강좌가 제가 선택한 대학에서 잘 열리질 않았어요. 저는 미술사를 공부하고 싶었기 때문에 철학의 한 분야인 미학을 공부하러 철학과를 갔는데 그 별로 제수이트 대학이어서 별로 미학 강좌가 잘 안 열리더라고요. 그래서 좀 학과의 재미는 못 붙이고 영화와 사진 쪽을 이렇게 이렇게 넘보고 있었죠.
Yes. Well, although you say that I studied philosophy at university, the university that I studied at, they didn't have this particular course that I was very much interested in. My main interest was to study art history, and because of that, I was looking forward to going to an aesthetics course, which is of course a part of philosophy. But the university that I went to was a Jesuit university, and they didn't hold many aesthetics courses. So I became quickly disinterested in the academic side of university life and started to glance sideways at the film or the photography and looking for ways to get into those.
지금 생각해 보니까 히치콕도 고등학교를 제수이트 학교를 나온 뭐 생각이 나는데 그러니까 아마도 뭔가 운명적인 게 연결이 있는 건가 싶기도 하네요.
Come to think of it, Hitchcock went to a Jesuit school as well. So maybe there's something, some fate involved there.
어쨌든 버티고를 봤어요. 그때 한글 자막도 없고 VHS 카피 여러 번 된 좀 열악한 화질로 봤는데 그 영화를 반도 다 보기 전에 완전히 그 매혹되어서 내가 그 샌프란시스코의 막 언덕길을 이렇게 막 그 여자를 쫓아서 다니는 그런 백일몽 속에 들어있는 기분이 들더라고요.
So it was during those years I saw Vertigo without any subtitles, and it was on a VHS copy which was dubbed a number of times, so the quality wasn't all that good. Not even halfway through the film, however, I was mesmerized by what I saw, and I felt like I was in a daydream, and I felt as if I was the one making my way up those hills in San Francisco, pursuing this woman.
그래서 그 영화를 본 기억이 너무나 나한테 큰 강렬한 영감을 줬기 때문에 그 소중한 기억을 좀 깨고 싶지 않아서 그 영화를 다시는 보지 않았어요. 여태까지 한 번도 본 적이 없습니다.
Because he had such a strong inspiration from the memory of seeing that film, it's such a cherished memory that because he didn't want to dispel it, he never actually went back to see Vertigo ever since.
그리고 그날 그 훗날 제 와이프가 될 여자를 처음 소개받은 그 영화 같이 보고 그 영화 클럽이었는데 같이 보고 나와서 소개를 받았죠.
And the screening was actually held by a film club comprised of film students, enthusiastic film students, students who were interested in film, I'm sorry. And they all watched Vertigo together, and afterwards they had a little get together, and that was when he was introduced to his wife.
Of course, the Vertigo itself is interesting because there are the film Stoker, well, the script Stoker was peppered with references to Hitchcock and Vertigo, probably most obviously in the shower scene. Yeah. Was that part of the attraction? Do you think?
그게 그러니까 사실 웬트워스 밀러가 썼을 때는 Shadow of a Doubt에 강한 영향을 받고 썼다고 하는데 Shadow of a Doubt를 본 지도 하도 오래되고 해서 저는 그거 눈치도 못 챘어요. 그래서 히치콕적인 각본이기 때문에 끌린 것은 아닌데 어찌 생각하면 또 그런 정보가 없을 뿐이지 그 각본 안에 담긴 히치콕적인 요소에 본능적으로 끌렸는지도 모르죠.
Well, to tell you the truth, well, Wentworth Miller said that he was under the influence of Shadow of a Doubt when he was writing the script, but it's been such a long time since he last saw Shadow of a Doubt, so he didn't even notice that when he was reading the script. But so he thought that he wasn't necessarily attracted to the script because of the Hitchcockian references. But come to think of it now, that it was just that he wasn't actively conscious of the fact, but he must have been somehow instinctively drawn to those Hitchcockian elements that were found in the script.
Yeah, and I think you have created in that film and many of your other films a kind of daydream, or we could say nightmare, a combination of daydream and nightmare that you were initially attracted you to Hitchcock's work. Yeah, the modern Hitchcock, perhaps, right here in Auckland. I want to ask a broad question. You were interested in art in the beginning, or in art history. What is it that excites you about this medium of film? You know, why not photography? Why not music? Why not theatre? Why not art?
Yeah, 반복되는 얘기지만 사실 영화가 가장 꿈하고 비슷한 성질을 가지고 있는 것 같아요.
Which maybe it's a reiteration on what he's already said, but film as a medium is probably the most similar medium to dream. It has the most similar characteristics to a dream.
말하자면 꿈을 꿈답게 표현하는 데 있어서 가장 그 효과적인 매체라고 할 수 있죠.
Probably the most effective medium to express in a dreamlike way.
그리고 꿈에서도 특히 초현실주의적인 측면. 제가 미술에서 제일 끌렸던 그 시대였죠.
Especially the surreal aspect of dream and how to express that most effectively, he found the film to be the medium in which he could do that.
Was he interested in dream? Were you interested in dream as a young student before you found film?
저는 그 영화를 제가 찾기 전에 그 학도로서 꿈이라는 것을 굉장히 끌리셨던 거예요.
예, 그랬던 것 같아요. 그러니까 그 당시에 그렇게 딱 규정을 해서 나는 그런 걸 찾고 있어라고 생각하진 않았지만 지금도 이렇게 보면 그런 것 같고.
Yes, he thinks so. Not that back then and he was consciously aware and he was able to say to himself that well, this is what I'm looking for. But thinking back, he must have been.
당시 한국 영화나 예술은 그 군사 독재 시절 하에서 뭔가 저항적이고 정치적이고 뭔가 그리고 저항적이고 정치적인 건 좋지만 너무 그것을 편협하게 그 표현하는 말하자면 좀 좁은 의미에서의 사실주의가 너무 그것만이 존중받던 시기였기 때문에 그런 것이 잘 저하고 적성에 맞지 않았어요.
At the time, however, the Korean cinema and the art scene in general were under the oppressive control of the military dictatorship. And the artists back then were very rebellious and very political. And it's good to be rebellious and political, but it just happened so that back then, the Korean cinema, ways of their expressions tended to be realism, but in the narrowest sense of the word. They were focusing too much on the issues at hand.
그런 상황에서 김기영이라는 노장 감독만이 한국 영화 또는 미술을 포함한 전체 예술 씬에서 거의 유일하게 초현실주의자적인 면을 보인 작품을 선보이고 있었죠. 그래서 제가 그 김기영 감독의 영화에 정말 그런 걸 보고 충격을 받고 내가 원하는 만들고 싶은 건 이런 거다라는 것 그런 걸 깨달았어요.
I'll just correct myself. Focused too narrowly on the way of expressing, which was narrow form of realism. But it was this film that he saw made by a Korean director called Kim Gi-young. He was the only one in the art scene who were using surrealistic ways of expression. And it came as a shock to him that it's such a thing as possible in Korea. And this is exactly the kind of film that I would like to make.
Kim Gi-young 감독은 하우스메이드라는 작품이 유명하죠.
Kim Gi-young is well known for the Korean film Housemaid.
아, 새로 만들어진 거 말고 옛날.
Not the recent remake, but the original.
Well, I think the surreal aspect of your work is part of what makes it so well, visually and viscerally striking. I'm very interested in the way that you approach, say, your fight scenes, and I use perhaps as an example the if you've seen Old Boy, the amazing fight scene down the corridor, which is played out almost like an Egyptian painting. It just tracks slowly along. It's in pretty much one shot with music. It's incredibly beautiful, incredibly violent, but so beautiful. I'm very interested in how your head conceives of such a way of depicting a scene that almost every other director in the world who creates violence would not do as you have done.
예, 확실히 예, 당신처럼 실화를 소재로 영화를 만든다면은 그런 연출을 해서는 안 되겠죠.
Well, for sure, if you were making a film based on true events like you have done, you wouldn't be depicting violence like the way he has done in Old Boy.
그 폭력 묘사는 제가 조심 항상 조심하는 거예요. 그러니까 그게 너무 이렇게 너무 통쾌하게 감정적으로 관객이 너무 통쾌하게 느껴지는 양식 후련해. 예, 그렇게 그냥 감정을 해소해 버리는 그런 식으로 만들면 안 된다는 거.
He's always careful with depiction of violence. He doesn't want to make it too cathartic for the audience.
그리고 또 어떤 뭐 어떤 스타일을 구사해서 너무나 아름답게 멋지게 그렇게 묘사하기도 싫다는 거.
And he doesn't want to depict it stylistically and just to be focused on presenting it beautifully.
무슨 뭐 슬로우 모션이나 뭐 그런 걸 쓸 수도 있고 뭐 아름다운 조명을 할 수도 있지만 그것이 그 자체로 그걸 이렇게 멋져 보이게 만들기 위해서 그 수단이 사용돼서는 안 된다는 거죠.
In other words, you can use techniques like slow motion, or you can employ a beautiful lighting for the scene. It's all possible, but if it's just there for the sake of aesthetics, it won't do.
물론 영화의 모든 것이 다 그렇습니다.
But of course, every aspect of filmmaking is like that.
그렇지만 특히 폭력은 폭력은 굉장히 위험한 것이고 제 영화에서 아주 중심적인 소재이기 때문에 좀 더 조심스럽게 다루려고 하죠.
But especially with violence, it's such a dangerous thing, and it's such a central element to his films, and that's why he's more careful when dealing with violence.
그러니까 중요한 것은 뭔가 감정입니다. 그러니까 어떤 고통, 어떤 분노, 후회, 이거 폭력 묘사, 폭력 장면 직후에 생기는 후회, 그런 것들을 어떻게 하면 효과적으로 다루느냐에 집중을 해야 하죠.
The important thing for him in depicting violence is the emotion. It could be pain, it could be anger, it could be regret, regret which happens right after an act of violence.
올드보이를 예를 들자면 거기서는 내가 제일 중요하게 생각했던 것은 고독이었습니다.
And with old boy, the emotion that he specifically had in mind was loneliness. So it has to. So it all comes out of the process of thinking what would be the most effective way of portraying that emotion.
그 장면에서는 어떤 특정한 그러니까 상대방이 어떤 뭐 굉장한 악인이 있어서 그와 대결하는 싸움이 아닌 것이 중요합니다. 그러니까 뭐 어떤 자기의 원수와 딱 직접 맞닥뜨려서 막 1대1로 싸우면서 자기의 분노를 표출하는 그런 액션 시퀀스도 있겠지만 이것은 여기서의 적수들은 전혀 캐릭터도 아닌 전혀 이름도 없는 그냥 한때 깡패들일 뿐이에요. 한 덩어리에. 그러니까 그들과의 싸움에서 어떤 개인적인 감정이 있는 것은 아닙니다. 이것은 하나의 상징 같은 거예요. 그러니까 이 주인공, 어떤 한 개인을 둘러싼 세계, 그에게 적대적인, 그를 굴복시키려고, 그를 무릎 꿇리려고 하는 어떤 운명 같은 것, 그런 것을 상징하는 거죠. 그러니까 그것과 맞서 싸우는 한 개인의 고독이 그 묘사가 필요했던 겁니다.
So it was important for him that the action sequence was a conflict between numerous villains against this one protagonist, and the loneliness that he feels thereof. Of course, there could be action scenes where the protagonist is locked in a fight with his nemesis on one-on-one. Fight and could express his anger towards his nemesis, but with this scene, he needed it to be one against many, and these many are the nameless bunch of thugs. They are not even proper characters, and it was important because the protagonist. Does not have any personal emotion against any single individual out of the group of thugs. And the importance of this is that what he wanted to portray there is the idea of an individual against the world. It's almost a symbol to say that this man is fighting a fight against fate, which is trying to bring him down to his knees. So that's why to symbolize this particular individual, the protagonist's lonely fight against fate, he needed the action scene to be the way it was.
The depth of thought that you've put into the scene shows in the scene. it's a great lesson for us all, I think. You deal in your filmmaking, and that fight scene, or many of your fight scenes are examples of this, in elemental human aspects, death, love, we'll just use those two as an example. Could you, and in one scene in Stoker, you bring those two together, I'm talking about the shower scene. I'd like to ask you about, I suppose, what attracts you to these elemental aspects of being human? And then, more specifically, how you conceived of the shower scene in Stoker.
Shower 장면은 거기서 중요한 것은 인디아의 그러니까 자기 자신의 기억과의 어떤 싸움 또는 기억 자기가 방금 전에 저지른 일과 자기의 현재의 감정 사이에 이 막 그 갈등을 빚기도 하고 또 거부하기도 하고 뭐 그런 이 두 가지 사이의 관계를 어떻게 다루느냐가 중요합니다.
The important thing about the shower scene is can be boiled down to India's battle against her memory between what she had just done and what she's the emotion that she's going through now. There's a conflict and there's denial. And between these emotions, it's the relationship between these emotions is the most important thing for him in the shower scene.
이 영화가 아주 아주 그 타고난 피 속에 뭐 어떤 악마적인 유전자를 가진 그런 그런 괴물의 각성을 다룬 영화다라고 볼 수도 있겠지만.
You could say that about this film that it's a film about a monster who is inherently evil, who in her blood has a devilish DNA, and she's only waking up to her instincts.
그 분명히 그런 측면을 가지고 있죠. 그렇지만 저는 또 그건 못지않게 그것과는 또 상반된 또 하나의 라인을 생각하고 있습니다.
Of course, there is an aspect that speaks to this in this film, but he's also thinking about another aspect.
이것은 그냥 모든 사춘기 소년 소녀가 어른이 되는 과정을 다룬 아주 보편적인 이야기를 좀 더 비유적으로 극단적으로 이렇게 과장한 이야기이기도 한 것이죠.
That it's also a story. A very universal story about all how every boy and girl go through puberty and come of age to become an adult. And he's making a very metaphorical, allegorical, and extreme exaggeration of that coming of age process.
I'm interested just to dive into the shower scene a little more. Just to explain for those who haven't seen the shower scene, it's a really amazing intercut sequence between India just after she's kind of witnessed and been involved in a murder. It intercuts her in the shower, sort of basically masturbating. And having a first sexual experience, I suppose, with the murder itself. And this intercutting, intercut sequences is somewhat of a trademark of your work, and I'm very interested to ask you, do you do that intercutting of two, what could be quite separate sequences? Do you conceive of that before you shoot, or is that really brought together in the editing process?
대부분은 거의 90% 이상은 스토리보드 단계에서 정해진 대로입니다.
In most of the instances, these are conceived during the storyboard process.
대개는 100%. 99% 스토리보드 비슷하지만 그 말씀하신 샤워 세퀀스는 워낙 복잡하기 때문에 편집돼서 조금씩 이렇게 정교화됐죠.
Usually it's 99% he would say is decided during the storyboard stage. But in terms of this shower sequence and the crosscut sequence around the pivotal masturbating shot. It was such a complicated sequence so that it was further refined during the editing stage.
그 핵심은 그거예요. 그러니까 사춘기 때 누구나 느끼는 어떤 악에 대한 유혹, 악에 자기도 모르게 끌리는 거 있잖아요. 관심을 갖는 거. 그것을 표현하려고 했던 것입니다. 그래서 살인을 언클 찰리 살인을 목격하는 것 그 생각이 계속 머릿속에 있고 그리고 점차 관객에게 드러나는 비밀은 단지 목격이 아니었다. 적극적인 동참이었다. 그래서 그 피 죽어가는 사람의 손을 꽉 잡아서 반항하지 못하게 함으로써 그래서 사실상 함께 살인하는 것이었다. 그것이 그녀에게 성적인 각성, 성적인 희열로 이끄는 방아쇠가 됐다라는 것입니다.
The core of it really is that he wanted to express the seduction of evil or this interest in evil that everyone can feel as they go through puberty, as they come of age. At one point or another that they are drawn to evil. And in during the shower scene, India is recalling the memory of her witnessing Uncle Charlie's murder. But as she keeps thinking about that, what gets revealed progressively is that she wasn't simply observing, watching what was happening. She actually was a proactive participant in the act.
When it was exciting.
Exactly, yeah. And that's what excited her. And you know, when you see her holding onto hands of the boy so that he can't free himself while he was being strangled, it really makes her she was participating really actively in that murder. And thinking about this moment that she was killing this boy together with Uncle Charlie, it awakens her, it acts as a catalyst or a trigger to her sexual awakening and sexual ecstasy.
네, 그래서 이 그런 장면들을 연출할 만들 때 편집실에서 갑자기 만들게 되면요. 그러니까 촬영할 때 그런 계산 없이 막 찍어놓고 편집실에서 대충 그렇게 섞어서 편집을 하면 그건 다 표가 나요. 그렇게 했구나 하는 걸 금방 알 수 있죠.
When you take a cross-cut sequence like this, and if you hadn't planned beforehand, and if you were just hoping to somehow throw it together with your fingers crossed, and it'll somehow work out in the editing suite, you can't really tell a sequence was put together like that way. So you need to really calculate beforehand how you're going to achieve this cross-cut sequence, and before you go into well before you go into shoot.
Music.
Mm-hmm.
I think you use music amazingly in your films. It's a powerful, in fact, music and soundtrack, incredibly powerful, almost operatic element. Could you tell us how you conceive of what music to use? Often it's classical. Whether that's while you're writing or while you're storyboarding, or is that something that comes in quite late in the process?
Yeah, 음악에 대해서는 미리 생각하지 않는 편입니다.
When it comes to music, he doesn't tend to think of what music to use so early on.
영화를 상당히 미리 이렇게 정교하게 스토리보딩을 하는 감독인 그런 편인데도 역시 다 만들어서 편집을 해놓고 나면 그때서야 이게 어떤 영화라는 것이 좀 구체화되지 그걸 미리 다 이렇게 하기는 어려운 것 같아요.
Even though he's a kind of filmmaker who meticulously storyboards out everything, the entire film from the beginning to the end, it's only when he actually finishes the shoot and go into post-production and finishes his edit that film takes a specific shape.
그러니까 음악이라는 것은 사실 가장 중요한 게 언제 시작해서 언제 끝나느냐를 정하는 거거든요.
The most important thing about using music is to decide when a music would start and when it would finish.
어떤 음악이냐보다 그게 더 중요합니다.
And rather than what music to use, this is a more important thing.
되게 젊은 그러니까 신인 감독들이 잘 실수하는 게 바로 그런 것인데요. 음악을 시작하고 끝나는 것은 우리가 그냥 많은 영화를 보아왔기 때문에 대충 누구나 비슷한 감을 갖고 있을 것이다. 대충 뭐 딱 보면은 여기서 시작하는 거 아닐까? 이렇게 쉽게 생각하는 사람들이 많아요.
And it's the trap that you know up and coming young filmmakers fall into quite easily. And they tend to think that you know in terms of where the music starts and ends in any scene everyone would have a pretty similar idea about that and don't pay so much attention to this.
그런데 그래서 이제 뭐 각본을 보고 야 여기 여기서부터 예를 들어서 주인공이 뭐 무슨 무시무시한 비밀이 담긴 지하실을 향해서 내려간다. 그럼 그 계단서부터 음악이 서서히 무슨 불길한 바이올린 소리 뭐 그런 것으로 슥 시작하면 좋지 않을까? 누구나 그렇게 생각하죠.
For instance, when you're reading a script, and for example, when we have a protagonist walking down the stairs into the basement, and there lies a scary secret ahead of her, you know, it's easy for someone to say that this is a no-brainer. I'll start the music as she walks down the steps. I'll start with some foreboding strings.
그렇지만 실제로는 그것을 언제 시작하느냐를 이렇게 앞당겨보고 뒤로 밀어보고 하는 것에 따라서 영화가 완전히 달라진다는 것을 경험할 수 있습니다.
But in reality, as you with the music, try to place it at a certain point, or bring it forward a bit, or push it back a bit, depending on the timing, you will experience that your film becomes an entirely different animals.
그래서 음악을 만들 때 제일 중요한 것은 이제 바로 이 개별 순간순간마다의 효과에 집중하기보다는 그러니까 그런데 매몰되기보다는 그게 쉬운데 영화 전체를 보고 이 영화 전체의 리듬을 결정하는 것이 음악이다라는 것을 명심하고 있는다는 겁니다.
So the most important thing when you are working on music for your film is don't fall into the trap of you know being too focused in each individual moment and the ways to maximize the effect on that each individual instances you need to have an overview and you need to think of your movie as a whole and think about the overall rhythm and that is the most important thing in using
너무나 많은 감독들이 또는 영화 음악가들이 그저 효과, 오직 효과를 어떻게 낼 것이냐만 자꾸 생각하는 것 같아요. 여기서 가장 효과적인 음악이 뭐냐. 그러면 곤란해요. 그러니까 그런 것은 일단 제껴두고 영화 전체 리듬을 보면서 이렇게 어디가 올라가고 어디가 내려가고 어디가 천천히 가고 어디를 빨리 가야 되고 이런 전체 리듬을 결정하는 것이 그런 관점에서 음악을 봐야 한다는 겁니다.
Too many directors and film composers, they're only focusing on the effect of music. What would be the most effective music for this particular moment? But you should push that aside and see the film as a whole and see how rhythmically you want to structure your film. Where it needs to be slow, where it needs to be fast, and you need to have this holistic approach.
You've just made your first English language film. How do you direct Nicole Kidman when you don't speak great English?
우선
How do you direct her so well?
어떻게 잘
get such a great performance?
우선 이제 제가 각본을 쓸 때 물론 한국말로 씁니다. 그리고 번역을 한 다음에 그것을 제가 감수합니다. 그리고 미국인 작가를 붙여서 한 줄 한 줄 단어 하나 하나 여기 쉼표 하나 하나까지를 이야기합니다. 그래서 제 의도를 전달을 정확히 하고 그 작가가 그것을 정말 자기 나름대로 소화해서 정확한 영어로 일단 표현하는 것 그런 일단 그 각본 집필 과정에서 특히 대사를 집필하는 과정에서 제 의도가 정확히 반영되도록 하는 것 그것이 먼저 제일 이제 첫 번째 일이죠.
Well, first of all, when he writes the script, he would write it out in Korean, of course, but he would have that translated. But he would proofread it to make sure that it reflects his intentions. Then he sits down with the English writer to go through each line, go through each word, each commas and each full stops to make sure that his intentions are conveyed in the most accurate manner. And once it's right, and once the writer has digested that, the writer would polish the script to make sure it's the most appropriate expression is made in English, not only, but especially in dialogue. So thereby he would go through these stages and check that his intention is reflected correctly from the beginning, from the script.
스토커의 경우에는 그 저 에빈 크리스타 윌슨이라는 그러니까 여러분 잘 아시는 세크레터리라는 작품을 그리고 또 잘 알려져 있지 않지만 또 하나의 걸작인 퍼를 집필한 에빈 크리스타 윌슨이라는 뛰어난 작가를 만날 수 있어서 참 행운이었죠.
And he was fortunate in Stoker to have worked with Erin Cressida Wilson, who's well known for her work, The Secretary, and less known but equally great film, Fur. And he collaborated with Erin during this process.
그다음에는 이 프리프로덕션 단계에서 배우들과 매일 만나서 토론하는 시간을 가졌어요.
And after that, during pre-production, he made sure that he had time to interact with the actors every day to look at the script together.
아침에 출근해서 얘기하고 도시 샌드위치 먹으면서 또 얘기하고 저녁 때 퇴근하고 하는 시간을 매일 같이 가졌죠.
So every day, he and his actors would get to the office and you know work together, nibbling on sandwich. And when it comes in the late afternoon, go home.
우리 세 주연 배우와 함께. 그러니까 제가 그들에게 말했던 건 이거예요. 그러니까 현장에서 무슨 의견 충돌이 생겨서 다투기 시작하면 우리는 답이 안 나온다. 우리는 통역을 통해서 그러니까 시간이 두 배로 드니까. 그러다가는 스케줄을 맞출 수 없다. 그러니까 모든 얘기는 미리 끝내놓자라는 겁니다.
The idea really was with the three main cast, Mia, Matthew, and Nicole. The idea was that you know, look, if we start having conflicts on set, you know, we're really screwed because we'll have to do that through a translation, and it would take twice as long. So if there's any arguments to be had. Let's have it now and get it out of the way.
니콜은 그런 경험이 많지 않고 그래서 그게 뭐 이런 게 필요할까요? 나는 완벽한 상태로 항상 현장에 가요라고는 태도를 처음에 보였지만 실제 이런 세션을 시작한 지 한두 시간밖에 지나지 않았는데 야 이거 정말 좋네요. 이거 지금 재밌고 보람 있고 효과가 있을 것 같네요라고 하더라고요.
Nicole, for instance, she hadn't had many instances where she would go to rehearsals during pre-production, before shoot, because she's such a well-prepared actress that, you know, do I really need rehearsals? I can prepare on my own and I can turn up and give my best there. In Director Park could see that she, her attitude was a little bit like this at the beginning, but as soon as we started the first session working with the actors. She immediately could see the value in it, and she was very very positive about the sessions. This is a great thing. It's such a fun session. It's very helpful.
Yeah, 그때 이제 주로 하는 얘기는 그런 겁니다. 대사를 말이죠. 뭐 액센트를 어떻게 하자 뭐. 이 단어를 말하고 나서 3초 쉬었다가 다음 이야기를 시작하자 뭐 이런 얘기를 하는 게 아니고요. 그런 기술적인 문제들은 한국에서도 배우한테 맡겨둡니다, 저는. 제가 하는 그러니까 그때 나누는 대화라는 것은 내가 이 대사를 왜 이렇게 썼는지, 내가 여기서 요구하는 감정이 뭐고, 이 영화 전체는 무엇에 관한 영화이고, 당신은 어떤 캐릭터인지 그런 것을 설명해 주는 거죠, 배우들에게. 대개 감독이나 작가들이 빠지기 쉬운 함정이, 아, 여기 다 써 있으니까 이걸 읽기만 하면 다 알아들을 거야 라는 오해인데요. 실제로 자주 그러진 않아요. 그러니까 아무리 자기가 잘 써 다 설명되어 있다고 하더라도요, 하나하나 정말 유치원생에게 떠먹이듯이 하나하나 설명을 해주면 그런 것이 필요하다고 생각해요. 그래서 그들의 지적인 능력을 무시해서가 아니라 내 의도라는 것은 그렇게 읽기만 해서 다 알 수 있는 건 아닙니다. 아마 내가 배우라도 마찬가지일 거예요. 내가 배우라도 어떤 감독의 어떤 작가의 작품을 해석할 때 내가 알아서 혼자서 하는 것보다도 그의 의도를 하나하나 다 듣고 나서 그 다음에 혼자 해석하는 그 과정이 필요한 겁니다.
And most of the discussions that take place during these sessions with the actors, it's nothing to do with technical aspect of the craft, so to speak. Like, there is no talk of, you know, I would like you to accent this particular, put an accent on this particular word, or I would like you to take 3 minutes pause here and then do so and so. You know, technical detail like that, even back in Korea, he just trusts the actor. But what he does spend time talking about with the actors is that he explains his intentions behind everything, why the dialogue is written that way, why this action is on page described in a certain way, and also talk about what the film is about as a whole, what the story is about. The easy trap that filmmakers can fall into, filmmakers, directors and writers, is the misunderstanding that, well, everything is on the page, so as long as I give that to the actor, they will read it and they would understand all of my intentions. But he feels that it's an important thing to explain each and every intention behind every word on the page, as if you were feeding a baby. It's not because he doesn't trust the actor's intelligence, but when it comes to a writer or a director's intention, it cannot be conveyed just by reading the script. He imagines that even if he was an actor who got a script, who received a script from a writer or a director, there is a limit to how much you can work out the intentions behind the work. It's only after you've had an ample discussion about every intention, that's when the actors can go take that and work on their own about their character.
And that's when you can truly, you know, get a performance that has maybe few words but a lot of depth, which I think is the one of the things that's quite remarkable about your work. It's often quite stylized and dreamlike, but it also has these performances that are deeply rooted in a human truth. Your characters are very committed.
토론을 할 때요, 일방적인 주입이 아니라 이제 그들의 또 반응이 있겠죠. 나는 그렇게 생각 안 하는데요, 라든가. 뭐 그래서 논쟁이 시작되는 거죠. 그래서 그 논쟁이 해결될 때까지, 예를 들어서 나와 니콜 사이의 논쟁인데 매튜와 미아도 옆에 있는 거예요. 그래서 그 자기 대사도 아니지만 끼어듭니다. 그렇게 해서 같이 만들어 나가는 거죠. 오늘 일과 시간이 끝날 때까지 해결이 안 나면, 누군가 승복하지 않는다면, 자, 그럼 집에서 생각해 오고 내일 다시 모이죠. 또 얘기하는 겁니다. 될 때까지.
But with these discussions, it's not a one-way thing. It's, you know, he's not forcing his ideas into the actors. The actors might, listening to his intentions, they might just as well put their hand up and say, well, I don't agree with you. I don't think the same as you do. And it would spark up an argument, a debate. And let's say if he is having a debate with Nicole about a certain intention behind what's on the page, let's say it's a line of dialogue, Matthew and Mia's there as well, and they would jump in as well with the others. Oh, well, I think this is such and such, and Mia might have something else to contribute. But so given during this work day, there would have this debate and try to work it out. If they can't, he will ask the actors, well, go home and think about it, and we'll get back together tomorrow and sort it out then.
And how many days rehearsal?
For 일주일 했죠.
A week.
니콜이 딸에게 막 그 저주를 퍼붓는 장면이 있는데요. 그 대사가 굉장히 길어요. 근데 그것이 아주 무시무시한 독설이에요. 그러고 나서 니콜의 생각은 여기서 끝나는 게 아니라 그런 말을 이렇게 막 뱉어놓고 좀 자기 자신이 좀 무서워지고 이런 무서운 말을 내가 딸에게 할 수 있나? 라는 생각이 드는 것은 어떨까? 그건 내 생각도 똑같았어요. 근데 과연 어떤 대사를 이제 추구할 것이냐가 문제인 것이죠. 그때 제가 뭔가 새로 만들 수도 있었겠지만 니콜은 애 엄마고 방금 또 새로운 딸을 낳은 지 얼마 안 됐고 그러니까 엄마로서 한번 생각해 봐라. 이런 상황에서 나올 수 있는 얘기가 뭘까? 아무거나 그냥 떠오르는 대로 한번 얘기해 보세요. 그랬더니 아주 짧은 몇 개의 문장을 막 얘기하더라고요. 한 뭐 20개, 30개쯤의 대사들을. 그 중에 두 개를 골랐습니다. 그게 지금 영화에 남아있는 것이에요. 인디아, 넌 누구니? 넌 나를 사랑하게 돼 있었던 거 아니야? 이것은 니콜이 만든 대사입니다.
Now, let's say Nicole has this big monologue in the film. It's something that very visceral that she says to her daughter. It's a long and very scary vitriol. And that was the monologue. But during these discussion sessions, during these rehearsals, Nicole thought it shouldn't just finish here, but there must be something at the end added to this. Evie, having just thrown this visceral vitriol to her daughter, quickly realizes what she's just said, and she's scared by what she said to her own daughter. And Nicole felt Evie needed to this emotion needed to be expressed. And Director Park was thinking exactly the same thing, actually. Well, he could have gone and have written something to put at the end of the original monologue, but because Nicole herself is a mother, and she had, at the time, recently had a new baby girl, so he asked her to, well, have a think about what Evie might say then, as a mother. And say whatever comes to your mind. And she had about 20, 30 short sentences that she came up with, short lines that she came up with. And Director Park picked two out of them. And that's, India, who are you? Aren't you supposed to love me? Which is how the monologue ends.
Two great lines in the film. Okay, can I just out of interest ask you, Wanjo, what's it like for a boy, from Victoria University, finding yourself on set with Nicole Kidman at all?
Well, I felt very privileged to be working with such giant talents as Director Park and Nicole, Matthew and Mia, my job required me to be alert at every moment so that nothing gets untranslated or everything that's said gets conveyed in the most accurate and the most timely manner. Mm. So.
And you're conveying emotion too, I guess, when you're talking to actors. You're talking. You're not talking in a direct. Always in a direct way. Very challenging.
Trying to do my best.
Yeah. Well, you did very well indeed.
But I have to. Thank you. But I can say one thing about working as a conduit between Director Park and his actors. Often it was that maybe it was due to the fact that we had that 1 week rehearsal where Director Park spent a lot of time with the actors and. Everyone involved in those sessions became very familiar with the material. Maybe that's the that was a good foundation to start from. But there were these magical moments during shoot where I would start to interpret what Director Park was saying to Nicole. So Nicole, Director Park would like, and then she would just say, "Oh, Director Park would like me to do so and so and so and so, right?" And That would exactly be right, yeah. Down to the last detail and nuance. And it's wonderful to see things like that happening, the way that Director Park and his actors are so in tune that they can almost communicate without any translation in between. Just by looking at each other, actors will figure out what Director Park wants.
Really shows. Let's open it out to. Hopefully, we've got microphones for discussion out to the audience. For hopefully, we'll get 10 minutes or so. We'll just keep going until we're kicked out, I guess.
Hi. Besides the language itself, what other differences or difficulties did you face in the transition from Korean cinema to the Western audience?
두 가지죠. 하나는 스튜디오의 존재죠. 물론 한국에도 그런 미국식 스튜디오에 해당하는 회사가 있습니다만은 그렇게 많이 간섭하는 편은 아니에요. 특히 나한테는. 그런데 이제 미국에 와서 Fox Searchlight이라는 회사와 맞닥뜨렸을 때 제일 처음에는 나를 당황시킨 게 바로 그들이 너무나 많은 질문을 나에게 하고 또 너무나 많은 자기들의 의견을 나에게 준다는 것이었습니다.
Well, there were two things. First of all, it was this idea of working with an American studio. Of course, in Korea, there are equivalents to these American studios. The Korean studios do exist, but when he's working with Korean studios, they tend not to be so, for the lack of the better word, interfering. So when he was working with Fox Searchlight, right at the beginning, he was really bewildered at the sheer number of questions that they had for Director Park and the sheer amount of thoughts and opinions they wanted to share with him.
처음엔 그렇지만 결국 이제 어떤 생각을 하게 됐냐면요. 이것은 그냥 주어진 것이다. 이것은 바꿀 수 있는 것이 아니고 싸울 수 있는 것도 아니다. 한국에 8월에 한국에 촬영을 하러 온 사람이 한국의 8월은 왜 이렇게 더워라고 말을 해 봐야 무슨 소용이 있겠습니까? 그렇게 싸운다고 해서 땀이 안 날까요? 그런 것처럼 이것은 그냥 받아들이고 그것에 내가 적응하는 수밖에 없다라는 겁니다. 그럴 때 나는 어떻게 생각했냐면은 이 사람들이 나를 방해하고 자기들의 영화를 만들려고 하고 그런 것이 아니라 어쨌든 관객들이 좋아할 영화를 만들겠다고 하는 것이기 때문에 때로는 똑똑한 소리를 할 때도 있고 때로는 바보 같은 소리를 할 때도 있지만 어쨌든 목적은 그것이기 때문에 그것은 나와 일치하는 것이죠. 그래서 나는 그들의 목소리를 관객의 목소리라고 치기로 했습니다. 그래서 영화가 만들어진 다음에 관객들이 아, 왜 이 중반부가 이렇게 지루해요? 라든가 그 대사는 정말 좀 웃겼어요? 라든가 라는 말을 할 수 있잖아요. 그런 것을 미리 듣는다라고 치자는 겁니다. 그런 태도로 하나하나 정말 나도 최소 그러니까 최대한의 성의를 담아서 반응을 했어요. 거기에 대해서 그들은 정말 나의 내가 얼마나 성의 있게 그런 거에 대응하는지를 느꼈을 테고 그래서 서로 간의 존중이 생겼던 것 같습니다. 그래서 지금 와서 돌이켜 보건대 그 과정은 사실 그때는 고통스러웠지만 지나고 나서 생각하면 생산적이었어요. 그렇지 않았다면 아마 그냥 대충 넘어갔을 이만하면 됐어라고 넘어갔을 것들이 논쟁 과정에서 세련되어지고 이렇게 말하자면 변증법적으로 이것도 저것도 아닌 제3의 좋은 아이디어들이 내 머릿속에서 나오게 되고 그렇게 해서 더 나은 영화가 만들어졌다는 데는 의심의 여지가 없습니다.
So, however, so he was bewildered at the beginning, but then he got to thinking that, well, this is something that is given. This isn't something that he can change. This isn't something that he can fight. It's much like a visitor going to Korea right now in August and complaining, why is it so hot in Korea in August? No matter how much that person might want to change or fight the weather, the person will still be sweating. The weather will still be hot. So he decided to embrace this and decided that he was the one who needed to adapt to the environment and these people, when they share their thoughts or ask questions, they're not really out there to interfere with him, nor are they out to make their own movie. But their aim is to make a movie that the audience can enjoy. And they would say a lot of things that are very smart. They may say a lot of things that are very idiotic too. But the aim, objective of all this is exactly in line with his, is to make a good film and good film for the audience. So he decided to take these sharing of thoughts and questions as a voice from the audience. As you watch a film in the cinema and as you come out as an audience member, you might have a lot of questions. Or you might find a certain section too drawn out, or you might find a certain piece of dialogue too awkward. And he just decided that these conversations, he's having an early conversation with the audience. Once he's taken on that attitude and become very diligent and sincere about all these discussions, they must have felt his sincerity and diligence too, and it led to a mutual respect. And looking back now, he thinks that at the time it was a painful process, but looking back now, he could see how productive a process it was, because arising from all these discussions, he was able to take an initial idea that he had and was able to turn it into something much more developed or sophisticated or more refined. It may not necessarily be the original idea that he had to start off with, nor would it be an idea that they came up with, but it challenged his idea so that he was able to refine it to arrive at a very good alternative idea.
Perhaps apply to the Film Commission here. Yeah, in terms of our attitude to the Film Commission. Don't shoot yourself in the foot, Rob.
Sorry. So that was the first thing.
Sorry.
second thing that was difficult about 네,
번째,
making the transition.
두 번째는 스튜디오의 두 번째 임원에 관한 얘기는 아니고요.
And so the second thing is not about the second executive at the studio, but it's something entirely different.
촬영 일정이 굉장히 바빴다는 겁니다. 한국에 비해서. 그래서 it was 빨리 찍어야 했다는 거죠.
Number of shoot days were shorter than what it was used to in Korea, so that it had to be shot much faster. He had to work much faster.
40 days. And what would you, what would your average, what would have old boy been?
60일, 그러니까 그건 스크립트마다 다르기 때문에.
Well, it depends on, it's different from script to script.
스토커라면은 한 60회 찍었을 것 같아요.
But if it was Stoker, he would have asked for 60 days. If it was in Korea, he would have had 60 days to shoot it.
그러니까 두 가지를 포기해야만 했습니다. 그러니까 항상 테이크마다 다 모여서 플레이백해서 보면 보는 거 그리고 현장 편집을 해가면서 그 두 가지 다 무엇을 위해서 필요한 거냐면 배우들과의 토론을 위해서 필요한 거였어요. 근데 항상 한 것은 그렇게 했습니다. 그래서 나는 그걸 제일 영화 촬영 과정에서 제일 즐기는 부분이었는데 그것을 포기하면 맞출 수 있는 일정이죠. 그래서 뭐 사실 따지고 보면 간단한 일이지만 또 어떻게 보면 또 제일 아쉽기도 했던 겁니다.
And in trying to make the film in 40 days instead of 60, he had to give up on two things that he would utilize in, back in Korea. First of all, it's you know, after each take, he would play back the take, but not only him for himself, but he would ask all the actors to gather around in a group, and in, he would invite the actors to have a look at the monitor, and he would invite discussions from you know, the producers and everyone that's on the set, and to really discuss what worked, what perhaps didn't, what the actors would like to do in the next take differently. And the second thing that he had to give up on was use of on-set assembly. Now, in Korea, he uses a person sitting there with a laptop and a Final Cut Pro or what have you, and just cut all those sequences together after each take immediately. So this is possible because he has storyboarded everything out. So instructions are there, if you like, for the assembly. And the this person, on-set assembly person, would, after each take, slot it into the sequence. That way, and he would view this with the actors. The actors are able to see the take in the context of the sequence. And that's conducive to, you know, them trying different ideas for the next take or seeing how a take really works in the context. So,
highly collaborative.
굉장히 협업적이시네요, 감독님. 그렇게 따지면.
예, 그런 걸 좋아해요.
He very much likes that to work in that way. But all of this serves one purpose, and it's to for him to be collaborative with the actors. And this is something that he enjoys the most of the filmmaking process. But if he was to do this, that's how it would end up being 60 days, and that's. Those were the things that he thought he had to give up on Stoker. But it's an easy thing to give up. All you have to do is not, but you become very lonely. and it's something, this sort of interaction using the playback review and on-set assembly review in real time, as it were, with the actors is something that he missed greatly.
Was shooting a short film, we should really cover this off before we finish, on an iPhone somewhat of a reaction to the Hollywood machine or against the Hollywood machine? Do the opposite?
아이폰으로 영화 찍으신 게 이제 할리우드의 그 구조에 대해서 이런 거에 대한 반동적인 그...
그래서 그게 전이잖아, 전이지. 그게 먼저.
Well, no, because iPhone short film came before Stoker.
Oh, I saw it.
But he actually did another short film after Stoker. So,
그건 Day Trip이라는 작품인데.
And that short film is called Day Trip.
그거는 말씀하신 대로.
But when he was doing that, it's as you said. It was after having worked in America, he needed to be back on a Korean set as soon as possible. So.
Can we take one more question? Can we take one more question, or are we? No. That's yeah. One more question. Yeah,
can you tell us what you're working on next?
다음 작품은 뭔지 말씀해 주실 수 있어요?
아 예. 아직 뭐라고 말하기 힘들어요. 그러니까
it's difficult to say.
미국 작품과 한국 작품 두 개를 준비하고 있는데.
He is in preparation for another American film and a Korean film at the same time.
네, 진행은 한국 영화 쪽이 더 빠른데.
But the process of preparing the Korean film, the preparation process is much faster.
그런데 이 스토커 바로 다음 작품으로 하기에 아직 좀 뭐랄까 준비가 덜 됐다라고 느껴 심리적으로 그렇게 느끼고 있어요.
But he feels that that Korean film to do that film right after having done Stoker, just psychologically he feels that he needs to be more ready.
왜냐하면은 because 또 다른 이거 소녀 영화거든요. 그 이번엔 더군다나 두 명의 소녀가
나오는. This Korean film is yet another film that deals with a female protagonist, two female protagonists at that.
그것도 사춘기 소녀.
Going through puberty, coming of age type of situation.
그래서 그걸 또 한다는 것이 연달아서 한다는 것이.
To do two films back to back that deals with girls that age, he feels not. He's not ready.
they're quite intense at that age.
그 나이 때는 꽤나 강력하니까요.
여러분 혹시 아시는지 모르겠는데 그 세라 워터즈라는 영국 작가의 작품이고요. 그래서 일본 한국으로 옮긴 이야기입니다.
And that Korean project that he just spoke of, he's not sure whether you've heard of the writer, but British writer called Sarah Waters. It's a book called Fingersmith. It's And he's going to adapt it into a story based at the turn of the century, early 20th century, set against the backdrop of Japan with some Korean characters in there. Of course, back then Korea was occupied by Japan, but so he's transporting the story to that to that context.
Look, we've got to wind up. I'd just like to, on behalf of the audience here, thank you both so much for coming all the way to Auckland to speak to us, to share your knowledge, your experience, and something of your vision. It's been inspirational to speak to you, and I'd like to thank you very, very much. Thanks.